Michigan 1986 Football Yearbook. The tradition continues. The story of the Big Ten champions.
I think the Michigan team this year has a lot of veteran players, particularly on offense. Key to our success will be how well our defense approximates the performance it had in 1985. If our defense can measure up to the defense we had a year ago, I think we'll be right in the conference race. Key players on our team, I think, primarily is the quarterback. Anytime you have a veteran quarterback, that's a great plus. But we're fortunate this year at Michigan to have a great one in Jim Harbaugh, who can do almost anything that you want done at that position and give you great leadership. So I would say that Jim would be our key player this year.
Preparations begin. The 1986 football season is approaching. It is 11 football games spanning three autumn months. For the Wolverines of Michigan, it means preparing for the toughest conference in the nation, the Big Ten. In 1986, the mood was set for the upcoming University of Michigan football season long before the first game by Wolverine linebacker Andy Moeller. It was Moeller who said, "It was time for Michigan to win the Big Ten and revisit the Rose Bowl." A preseason prediction that did indeed become a reality. Coach Jim Beckler comments on his 1986 Wolverine squad.
Basically speaking, our offense has to be better than it was a year ago. We sincerely hope that it will be. You win and lose in this conference on defense. If our defense can measure up to what it was a year ago, then we should have a pretty darn good football team. If it doesn't, well, then anything can happen. But by and large, in football, I think the most important factor of all is whether we have the great attitude. Our attitude in 1985 was sensational. We must have the same attitude in 1986.
Great team success starts and finishes at the grassroots level, which is the talent and internal makeup of the players themselves. In 1986, the list of standout players, big plays, and dramatic comebacks helped distinguish this team as one of the greatest in the annals of University of Michigan football. At the helm of the Michigan drive was quarterback Jim Harbaugh. To say that this 6'3", 207-pound senior from Kalamazoo, Michigan had a storybook career would be an understatement. Season's end, Harbaugh would have the local typesetter resetting the pages that dealt with virtually all of the Michigan passing records. He established new single-season records in pass attempts, completions, and passing yardage, while becoming the first Wolverine quarterback to pass for over 2,000 yards in a single season. It was also during the 86 campaign that he became the first Michigan quarterback to throw for over 300 yards in a single outing. The date was October 4th. And the opposition was Wisconsin in their Big Ten opener. By game's end, Harbaugh had riddled the Badger defense for 310 passing yards. Good for one aerial touchdown and Coach Bo Schembechler's 200th career win. For his career, Jim Harbaugh stands alone in Michigan football history as the Wolverines' all-time leading passer. Among some of his other accomplishments in 1986, he led the Big Ten in total offense and passing efficiency, was a player of the week for his efforts against Michigan State, and took third place in Heisman Trophy balloting. Harbaugh earned all Big Ten first-team honors, both for athletics and academics, and was voted Michigan's most valuable player and the 1986 Big Ten Player of the Year. It may be the greatest testimonial to Jim Harbaugh comes of the fact that he led the men of maize and blue to victory 86% of the games in which he started. In 1985, the pass-catch combination of Harbaugh to split end Paul Jokic was virtually unstoppable. But as the 86 season unfolded, the combination faltered due to injuries that plagued Jokic throughout the season. Heading into the Big Ten opener against Wisconsin with only one start under his belt, senior split end Ken Higgins would be called upon to pick up the slack. His response to the call of action was remarkable. Against the Badgers, he proved to be Harbaugh's favorite target, as he was on the receiving end of eight passes, good for 165 yards, marking the second best performance by a Big Ten receiver during the entire campaign. Season's end, Higgins accounted for more receiving yardage than any of his Wolverine teammates. Just one reason why this straight-A student earned Big Ten first-team all-academic honors and took first-team academic all-American honors. It should also be noted that Higgins finished first of all those who took the Michigan Law School exam. While the Michigan Aerial Circus was flying in record fashion, the Wolverines' ground attack was as effective as ever. Leading the cavalry assault was tailback Jamie Morris. If anyone believes that you have to be physically big to play like an All-American, Morris, who stands all of 5 feet 7 inches tall and weighs 179 pounds, is living proof that this simply is not the case. Morris, only a junior from Ayer, Massachusetts, who has led the Wolverines in rushing the last three seasons, By season's end, was the Big Ten's leading all-purpose runner despite missing a game due to injury. This accomplishment earned him first-team All-Big Ten honors by the United Press International. While the offense was averaging over 460 yards per game, the Wolverines' defense was allowing its Big Ten opposition only about half that amount. Leading the way was inside linebacker Andy Moeller, Michigan's eighth all-time leading tackler. Moeller, a 6'2", 222-pound senior from Ann Arbor, Michigan, led the Wolverines in stops for the second straight year. An effort that earned him the honor of being named a consensus All-Big Ten first-team selection. One of his finest moments during the 86 season came against Wisconsin. In this one, Moeller intercepted three Badger passes and was voted the Big Ten Defensive Player of the Week. Of all the standouts of the 1986 Michigan football team, only one has lettered four consecutive years. This honor is held by quarterback Garland Rivers. Rivers, a 6'1", 187-pound senior from Canton, Ohio, has been the picture of consistency. For the second straight season, Rivers has led the Michigan secondary in tackles and was voted as a first-team All-Big Ten performer by the United Press International. Offensive tackle John Elliott, a 6'7", 306-pound senior from Lake Ronkonkoma, New York, was an all-consensus first-team Big Ten selection. Other honorees included linebacker Mark Messner, a 6'3", 248-pound junior from Heartland, Michigan, who was named first-team All-Big Ten by the Associated Press. And offensive guard Mark Hammerstein, a 6'4", 285-pound senior from Wapakoneta, Ohio, was an all-consensus first-team Big Ten selection. As the Wolverines were quietly putting together the longest unbeaten streak in Coach Jim Beckler's 18 years at Michigan, it was the Iowa game on the 18th of October that caught the nation's attention. On this day in Ann Arbor, Michigan, it was the Big Ten's only two unbeaten teams preparing to meet. The Wolverines looked poised and prepared, while the Big Ten's defending champions claimed their countless number of walking wounded might not be competitive. But when the contest began, all the pregame banter was forgotten. As the Hawkeyes took the opening kickoff and marched 80 yards for a 7-0 lead. Then after a halftime of inspiration Michigan style, quarterback Jim Harbaugh got the Wolverines back in the game. Harbaugh found fullback Gerald White on the other end of a 25-yard scoring strike. To be followed by a White touchdown run of 10 yards, which gave Michigan a 17-10 lead. A lead that would not last. Iowa, with the help of a deflected pass, took it in from 19 yards out to tie the score at 17. Then with time running out, the Hawkeyes were looking unstoppable. But like they say, looks can be deceiving, as Iowa quarterback Mark Vlasic fumbled at midfield. Thus, the stage was set for another photo finish between two of the Big Ten's best. With only seconds left, Michigan placed kicker Mike Gillette, who had earlier kicked the longest field goal in Michigan history, one from 53 yards out. Now needed one more if Michigan was to win. From 34 yards away, Gillette was on target. The final score was Michigan 20 and Iowa 17. As the Wolverines continued to win, it was the Minnesota Golden Gophers that provided a surprise of the season by upsetting Michigan 20-17. A setback that came only 1 week before the Ohio State showdown. Yet despite the disappointment, Jim Harbaugh served notice that the Wolverines were far from being a beaten team, as he announced that not only would Michigan bounce back, but would defeat Ohio State in Columbus. With the Big Ten championship and a trip to the Rose Bowl on the line, Ohio State wasted little time in its attempt to shatter Jim Harbaugh's crystal ball. After one quarter of play, it was the Buckeyes 14 and Michigan 3. Offensively, Ohio State was dominating during the first 15 minutes, outgaining the Wolverines 157 yards to 82. But from quarters 2 through 4, it was the Michigan offense that took over by outgaining the Buckeyes 447 yards to 203. Michigan comeback began with a 34-yard Mike Gillette field goal to make it 14-6 Ohio State at the halfway mark. Then after the intermission, the Michigan offense really got into high gear. Behind the running of Jamie Morris, who weaved and bobbed for 154 of his 210 yards in the second half, an effort that was unequaled by any other running back in the Big Ten during the 86 season. The Wolverines outscored Ohio State 13-3 to lead 19-17. Then in the fourth quarter, each team exchanged touchdowns. Michigan on a 7-yard run by Thomas Wilcher, with Ohio State countering on a 17-yard touchdown pass from Jim Karsatos to Chris Carter. But with 61 seconds left to play, the championship of the trip to the Rose Bowl all boiled down to a 45-yard field goal attempt by Ohio State's Matt France. The kick had the distance, but not the direction. The final score was Michigan 26 and Ohio State 24. On January 1st, 1987, the 73rd annual Rose Bowl was one that was filled with pageantry and pregame excitement. Entering the game, it was anyone's guess as to who would emerge the victor, because co-Big Ten champions Michigan and Pac-10 title holders Arizona State were so evenly matched. In the early part of the game, the sellout crowd, one that was complemented by an international television audience and radio coverage that was heard around the world, came to realize why Michigan quarterback Jim Harbaugh has been the most productive signal caller in college football during the past two seasons. With Arizona State showing its strength against the run, Harbaugh promptly moved the team on a series of big pass plays. Then, with the ball on the Arizona State 18-yard line, the pass-conscious Sun Devils were stung by tailback Jamie Morris, who galloped for 18 yards and 6 points. To the surprise of almost everyone, the Wolverines, who had lined up for a one-point conversion attempt, went for two, as place kicker Mike Gillette connected with running back Gerald White. Then, to the second quarter, the Wolverines were on the march again. The drive went 58 yards in 9 plays, capped off with a 2-yard dash by Harbaugh to put Michigan up 15-3. Even though the final score favored Arizona State, Michigan's appearance in the Rose Bowl kept one of the most amazing streaks in college football alive. In Coach Jim Beckler's 18 years at Michigan, every class he has recruited has made at least one Rose Bowl appearance. A tradition of excellence is more than a label when it comes to Michigan football. It's a fact. As the Wolverines have won more games than any other Division I-A school, they hold the record for the most Big Ten victories and Big Ten championships. Michigan has also appeared in 12 consecutive bowl games. The team's performances have been impressive. The Wolverines' fan support has been every bit as great. The last 72 games, Michigan Stadium has been filled by over 100,000 fans, helping the Wolverines lead the nation in home attendance for the 13th consecutive season. As the season closed of the 1986 regular campaign, the University of Michigan's accomplishments were fitting of a victor. In Big Ten play, the Wolverines led the conference in scoring, total offense, and total defense. And as the appropriate touch to a great season, Coach Glenn E. Bo Schembechler became the winningest coach in Michigan history. All reasons why the tradition continued and why the Michigan Wolverines were the Big Ten champions.